More and more children are out of school, but parents don't want math learning to stop. They're turning to Mathnasium at home. Real-time math instruction tailored to your child's exact educational needs. It's the same face-to-face live instruction used in our centers for over 15 years, now on a computer. Your child can keep their math skills sharp, catch up, or soar ahead, from home or anywhere with an internet connection. To learn if Mathnasium at home is right for your child, visit mathnasium.com/at home. Mathnasium at home, changing lives through math.
Good day. Just a moment, folks. Okay, let's get started. Sorry about all that confusion, folks. Let me start again. Good day and welcome to the Mathnasium Schoolhouse. My name is Larry. Before we begin our lesson today on using rulers, I'd like to do a quick mental math exercise with you. So let me change the screen here. Let's go to the whiteboard. And what we're going to do is we're going to start with the number 16 and start cutting it in half. And since I have access to the chat box, I would very much like to have you folks chime in here. So how much is half of 16? Bring it on. Let me see that in the chat box, folks. Okay. Looks good. Half of 16 is 8, indeed. And half of 8, someone's chimed in. I couldn't quite read the name. It's 4. And half of 4, of course, is 2. Half of 2 is 1. Most people are pretty comfortable up to here. Now we're going to keep going. How much is half of 1? Well, in one of our previous videos, we pointed out that half of 1 is a half. After all, a half and a half make a whole. So now we have half of 1 is a half. How about half of a half? We take each half and cut it in half. We will have 4 parts, and so we have 1/4. How about half of 1/4 now, folks? Again, back in the chat box, half of a fourth is... Not 4. Ah, half of a... I'll look at the chat box. There we go. Half of a quarter is 1/8. We'll see this in a little more detail when we get into using the ruler. And finally, half of 1/8 is 1/16. Now notice the lovely symmetry here about the number 1. If we go to the left, the number is double. If we go to the right, the numbers are cut in half. And this little bit of logic right here is going to be extremely important as we take a look at how a ruler is organized. So let's start with the top picture here. From 0 to 1, that's 1 uncut. This is a model of 1 inch. And if we take that inch and cut it in halves, then we have a picture that looks like this. Now most rulers don't stop at a half. What they do is they then take the half and break it down into half of a half here and half of the other half here. So now we have 1/4, just like we had on our line of numbers. And then if we keep going, half of a fourth we said was 1/8. And so let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yep, we have 8 parts here. So now we have 1/8. And some rulers actually stop there, but most of the rulers you're going to be seeing at school Start with an inch, go to a half, a quarter, an eighth, and then they take it to that last step here, and what you get is this, excuse me, this 1-inch model is now first, it's been broken in half, then half of a half, then half of that, and half of that. So in between here we have 16 marks. And so, question, what happens here with a real ruler? Well, let's see, let me put a ruler down here. In fact, I think I have an even better graphic for that. Other than that, let me go with this. Here we go. Let's take a look now at 2 inches. Well, the first inch followed our scheme of half and then half and then half again. And indeed, between 1 and 2, the same exact thing happens. We have exactly the same set of marks. And if we could zoom down on the ruler here, what we would see is that between each mark, between the 0 and the 1, the 1 and the 2, all the way up to between the 11 and the 12, in this case on this 12-inch ruler, they're always broken into 16ths. So once we know what happens between 0 and 1, we actually know what happens between any consecutive inches, between 3 and 4, 7 and 8. It's always going to be the first mark is at half, and then that's consecutively broken down until we get to 16ths. Okay, let's see what we can do now about naming some of these points. I've shown you a lot of various lines on this model, but let's drill down a little bit deeper here and take a look at this. Take a moment. By the way, this ruler has been broken down to eighths. It's with this kind of camera, it's a little hard to get those 16ths to show up really, really well. So, question. What does the letter A represent, and then B, C, and D? And again, let's put those in the chat box. If you'd be so kind as to put A equals B equals C equals. And let's see what we got here. See a lot of answers flowing toward the chat box. Let's see what kind of answers we actually have. Okay, hey George, that's exactly right. Letter A is the halfway point. Half on this side, half on that side. And how about letter B? Ah, very good, Sandra. That is indeed 1/4, because we have 1/4, 2/4, and 3/4 here, and 4/4 would be way over here. Okay, now how about letter C? Okay, remember this thing is marked in eighths. So what is letter C? Well, let's see, here's the halfway point. See, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and finally 5/8. Hey, good job, Rose. How about letter D? Okay, letter C is indeed 5/8. How about letter D? Ah, good. Again, Rose chiming in there. Letter D is indeed 7/8, and let's count that off properly. Remember I said these were done in eighths, so we have, of course, start at 0, 1/8, 2/8, which is 1/4, 3/8, 4/8, which is half, 5/8, 6/8, which is 3/4, and finally there's letter D is 7/8. Can someone tell me between which two letters is 3/8? Is it between A and B, A and C, C and D? Where is 3/8 on this? What letter is representing 3/8? Oh, come on, guys. I'm not seeing any new answers here. Okay, well, let's see. We come over here. Ah, now I'm starting to see answer. Good. Maybe there's just a delay in the feed here. Indeed, between A and B here, B is 1/2, A is 4/8, so right between there is going to be 3/8. Very nice. Okay, so let's actually do a little bit of measuring here, because in the real world, this is what inches are used for. So I've got 3 lines drawn here. Okay. So here we go. Let's see. I think I'll use this ruler for this job today. Okay, first thing to notice is we don't start at the very edge of the ruler. What we're going to do is notice that the zero mark, there's a little space between the end of the ruler and the zero mark. So we need to make sure that we line up our ruler so that we can see that we're truly at the beginning. And in this case, that comes out to be, looks like exactly 3.5. We got to this mark right here, right between the 3 and the 4. And so that line is it's not just 3.5, it's 3.5 inches long. As your teacher always tells you, put your labels on, as we always say at Mathnasium, tell us 3.5 what. Okay, so in measuring the next line, I pointed out that the ruler has that little space at the end. Now, I know from being a student myself many years ago and from being a classroom teacher that the rulers that are passed out in school sometimes are not in the best shape. In fact, if we take a look at this one very carefully, we can see that bottom end there has been really smashed up a bit. But this does not mean the ruler is not usable. What we have to do is adjust how we start. So remember, this line was 3.5 inches long. Well, I'm going to measure it now a little bit differently. Instead of starting at, if you will, 0, I'm going to start at the number 1. And when I set that down, and then I count off how far it is to the end, 1, 2, 3. Now it says 4.5, but remember we had an extra inch at the beginning, so it's really only 3.5, just as we got with the other ruler. So if you have a ruler that's damaged, a really good strategy is to not start at the 0 point, but move to 1, and then remember at the end of the process that you got to take that 1 away, because otherwise your answer is going to be 1 inch too big. Okay, let's go back. In fact, let's do that again here with the damaged ruler, starting at 1 for the next line here. And when I come across here, it is really spot on. 1 here, 7 over here. So how long is the line? Please pop that in the chat box. Good job. Okay, it says 7. Take away the inch we don't need. And indeed, this line is 6 inches long. And then finally, for the last one here, line it up properly, 1 at the beginning. Okay, now when I measure that out, it comes out to be 7 and 2 marks, and each one of these marks is a 16th. So where am I? Well, first of all, the whole number of inches is 6, 7 take away the 1. It's 6 and 2 more marks. That would be 2/16. And for those of you who know, excuse me, 6 and 2/16. So it's going to be 6 and 2/16. And many of you know that can be reduced to 1/8. So the process of reading a ruler is a very straightforward proposition once you understand how it's organized. So let's go back to the beginning, if we may, and take one more quick look at how the ruler is. Got way over there. Yeah, we went from an inch with no marks between. We cut it in half, then we cut those in half, and then we cut those in half. And finally, we did that to the whole thing, and we wound up with 16 parts in here. So understanding that gives you the tool that you need to be able to use a ruler effectively. Now, question, when do you actually in real life use a ruler? For instance, what can be measured with an inch, with inches? I'll wait, the chat box is running a little slow here, but I would love to hear your answers to that. What are a thing or two that you can measure in inches? Someone asked what grade this is for. I teach this to kids in second grade through adults. Depends on whether you understand how a ruler works or not. So kids in second grade, usually we stop it around an 8th rather than a 16th, but kids that young can handle this, and definitely kids in upper elementary and middle school most kids need this because, you know, in our modern culture, kids are not using rulers all that much. When I was a kid, back in the 50s, my dad and I used to do woodworking on weekends. And so all the time we were using tape measures and rulers and all kinds of measuring devices. So measuring became pretty second nature. If I was a kid in these times, I may not be doing woodworking. I might be playing video games or any of the other bazillion things that are available to kids. So For people who don't have the experience of dealing with a ruler, there's no grade level associated with this. It's a matter of do you know it or not. Okay, so let's see what I'm hearing here now. What are some things we can measure? Somebody says anything. That's very true. Cups, toys, your head. What else? Toes. Yep. Would inches be a good unit of measure to measure the distance to the moon? Why or why not? Again, the question is, would inches be the right unit of measure to measure the distance from the Earth to the moon? Yay or nay? Again, it looks like the chat box is running about 20 seconds behind me. Okay, I hear people saying no, definitely not a good idea to measure it in inches. And why not? Because inches are too small. That's a good answer to it. Because we'd have to report millions, maybe billions of inches to get ourselves from the Earth to the moon. But mankind has done something very smart. We start with inches. Let me switch back here for a second. Okay. And there we go. So we start with inches. After a while, we start building up, go, wait, that's kind of a lot of things. So let's come up with a new unit. We'll call it a foot. And folks decide to make that number of inches in a foot 12. We'll be talking about that in just a minute. So then we have a foot, which is good for measuring low, like your height, the distance across a room. But again, probably not the right unit of measure to measure the distance to the moon, because there'll still be way too many of them. So we got inches, we got feet. After a while, we decided that we needed something really big, and so the ancients came up with a unit of measure called the mile. And a mile, in case you don't know this off the top of your head, is 5,280 feet, which means every time you drive a mile, what you're driving is 5,280 times as long or far as this ruler is long. That's kind of an interesting perspective, that it's so many on the one hand and seemingly so few on the other. So that mile is probably the right unit to measure for measuring the distance from the Earth to the moon, which is over 200,000 miles to get there. So what else can we measure in miles besides the distance to the moon? What else seems a reasonable thing to want to use that with compared to using inches or feet? Somebody said you can measure your toenails with inches. Indeed, you can. I'd probably use some fractional parts in that. What else can we measure in miles? Okay, the distance from home to school, good. Anybody else? Okay, yeah, you can measure kilometers with miles, although that would be an interesting thing to do. Neptune, good call. Either the distance to Neptune or the distance across Neptune, any of those things. So, I mentioned that there were 12 inches in a foot, and that number 12 was not picked out of thin air. There's a very good reason why 12 is picked. You know, stop and think about it. There are a number of things in our culture that are measured in 12s. Stop and think for a moment. What's measured in 12s in our world? Those answers from the last one are coming up. A black hole would be something you measure in miles, probably light years at that point, and lots of miles. A parade, the sun. But so what kind of things come up measured in 12s in our world? Well, 12 inches in a foot, what else is composed of 12s? Any takers? This is moving. Okay, let me think. A couple of things that come to mind immediately. A year is 12 months. There's 12 things in a dozen. And so we use 12 to measure things, and there's a very good reason why the number 12 is picked. And that reason is because we can break it into whole number parts very easily. So let me switch back to the whiteboard here. So if I take the number 12, if I break it into two parts, that is halves, I get the whole number 6 as the number of inches. If I look at a third, this would be 12 inches. A third of 12 is 4. Now, what I mentioned was these come out in whole numbers, which is very convenient when you're measuring things. It would be kind of awkward if this came out, if half a foot came out to be like 5.937 inches. No, this comes out to be was picked very much on purpose so that when we do fractional parts, we get whole numbers as the answers to the problems. So that works for inches. If you're thinking about 12 months in a year, that can be broken into like four parts, which are called calendar quarters. So this number 12 is a very important number in measurement. And one of the first things that most kids learn is that they're 12 months in a year, and then 12 inches in a foot. The number we started with here today, that's 16. That number was also picked for a very good reason. As we saw in the very beginning of this video today, we took 16 and we could very nicely cut it in half into 8, 4, 2, 1. And then we got those same numbers as fractions, 1/2, 1/4, 1/8, 1/16. That's also the reason, by the way, why there's the same number, 16 ounces in a pound. Because, again, being able to cut something into fractional parts and have the answer come out a whole number is very, very convenient in the real world. So the numbers 12 and 16 pop up in measurement, and I want you to be very clear that those choices were not just pulled out of thin air. They were picked so for the convenience of the people using numbers, which is like everybody. So our pathway to understanding units of measure begins today, and those two numbers are the first two that we'll be dealing with in future videos. We'll be looking at a number of other units of measure as being one of the important applications of math in the real world. So let's go back to the very beginning here. There's my ruler, I mean my eraser. Excuse me, here we go. Okay. So I'm going to draw out here. Okay, I could. Someone tell me in the chat box. I didn't put all the marks in here. So actually, yeah, I might as well just go ahead and put them all in. So this was a ruler marked in eighths. So what is the value of A? We saw that in a previous one. Want to make sure that you, this is still looking proper to you. So what do we have? Yep, good. A is, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, halfway, 5, 6, 7. So A is 7/8. And B, 1/2 or 1/2. We could either call that 2/8 if we counted the eighths, or it could be 1/4 if we count it by fourths. So this, good, 7/8, 7/8. Excellent. In fact, let's do one more like that, because that's such an important thing to be able to identify these things. And this time I'll do it with the 16th here. Can someone in the chat box please tell me, I want to put a mark on, let's see, what do I want? 9/16. So where should I put that mark? See, lots of good answers in the chat box. Some people saying 2/8 for the last one, and some folks saying 1/4. Okay, but what I want to know now is, where is the point, if I didn't say it right before, 9/16. Where am I going to find that in this? I mean, it almost looks like a number line. That space between 0 and 1 on the ruler, and that space between 0 and 1 on the number line look very similar. So where is that going to be, the 9/16? Sorry for the delay here, but the chat box is running slow. How many was that? Oh, somebody asked, how many feet in a mile again? That number is 5,280. And that was picked by the ancients because it turns out it has lots and lots and lots of factors, just like 12 does, and which makes it very convenient to break a mile into, like you can break it into three parts, which are called yards, and there's 1,760 yards in a mile. It's also often broken into furlongs, used in horse racing and a few other things. And a furlong is an eighth of a mile. And all the 5,280 can be divided by a whole bunch of different numbers. Like there's altogether, there are 48 of them. So it makes it a very convenient number to deal with. The chat box has now finally caught up to real time. And I like what I'm seeing here. The line, people are saying it two different ways. The first line after 1/2, and that of course is correct because half is 8/16. So the next mark would be 9/16. And someone else said it's halfway between the half mark and two marks down, which is again that same exact place. So there's 9/16. How about 3/16? Where am I going to find that on the number line? So we got that one over here. Okay, let me pull the chat box over here a little bit. A lot better. Okay. Any other takers for this last one? Where am I going to locate that 3/16? The third line, 1, 2, 3, good. That would be 3/16. Any other, whoops. Any other way to describe? Okay, Alexander, that's good. 3/16 is a third of 9/16, which of course is exactly right. Not very helpful in putting it on the chart, but a great observation. Because indeed, 1, 2, 3, that's 1/3, 1, 2, 3, that'd be 2/3, and 1, 2, 3, 3/3. So it is indeed 1/3 of that. Which, by the way, is a coincidence, but a great observation there, Alexander. Okay, the line before 1/4, so lots of different ways to describe this. And kids will tell you this in many different ways. And the key thing, of course, is to make sure that they're using the right, whether it's eighths or sixteenths, in responding to these questions. Okay. One last thing to do before we wrap up here today. Some rulers, not commonly found in schools though, are done in sixteenths. Excuse me, are done in, this school ones are done in sixteenths. And sometimes they're done in 32nds. And so those units are, we cut each one of those sixteenths into half. And so you got a bunch of really, really, really small parts. So with this 16th inch picture here, I'll work over on this side. We'd have to break it here and there. So the moral of the story there is when you pick up a ruler, go to between any 2 inches and see how many marks there are, because that's going to tell you what the value of each one of the marks is equal to. And if you assume that all rulers are the same, you'll be very wrong, because as I mentioned earlier, sometimes at school you're going to be seeing rulers done with 8 marks between. More commonly will be 16. And fairly rarely will be, as I have on the screen here, done in 32nds. But again, I want you to be aware of that. Okay, well, thank you very much for joining us today at the Mathnasium Schoolhouse. And please join us for our next edition coming up at 11, excuse me, at your time tomorrow. And I'll see you then. Bye-bye.
It's afternoons that seem to be the most hectic for us, so it was much more convenient when we found Mathnasium at home.
All right, so how do we do half of 5?
I think one of the best things about at home is that it really feels like you're almost at home with the student in their house teaching them.
I'm in my comfort zone.
You can just ask for help and the instructor will come right to you.
With Mathnasium at home, I know that they're getting the help that they need.
Awesome, great job.
Mathnasium, changing lives through math.